in Tribeca, right next to De Niro, but I'll be hood forever. I'm the new Sinatra, and since I made it here, I can make it anywhere. Yeah, they love me everywhere. I used to cop in Harlem, all of my Dominicanos right there up on Broadway. Pulled me back to that McDonald's, took it to my stash spot. 560 State Street. Catch me in the kitchen like a Simmons whipping pastry.
Why on earth am I playing Jay-Z? Well, because I'm going to talk about context and using context as a clue to figure out the meaning of unknown words. Oh. And what Jay-Z does is he uses a metaphor in the Empire State of Mind. And the Empire State of Mind is basically, it's showing his, you know, his stature and who he is. And New Yorkers are known to not be afraid of anything and to conquer whatever it takes. And if you're in a New York state of mind, you're in a good place. You know, you're, you know, the lights and the energy of the city, and that is a metaphor, and he uses that as a metaphor. And all good artists use metaphors in their songs and in their work. So today we're going to talk about a little thing called Catch a Clue, if I can figure out. Close the library. There we go. How to view it. Yeah, because this is a new tool for me. All right, here we go. Let's make it bigger. Catch a Clue is using context as a clue to discover the meaning of unknown words. Woohoo, it's going to be so much fun, I promise. Okay, so BOLO, be on the lookout for hidden meanings. Remember, the meaning of a word depends on the context or the way it was used. So if you were with me in the last video, we talked about the word cold, and you could be cold-blooded or you could have cold feet. And today we're going to focus on using context clues to figure out the meaning of more unknown words. Think of context clues as words that surround an unknown word and help in identifying it. Many of the words around the unknown word suggest or lead to the meaning. So ask yourself just two questions every time you don't know the meaning of a word. Number one, what words around it tell you something about the word, and what words would go together with this word? So it's kind of like doing a little bit of detective work. So I'm going to read this little piece. It's the first paragraph from Edgar Allan Poe's short story, The Black Cat. And what Poe was a master of was gaining the reader's attention right away, and he used punctuation and he used capitalization, he used any type of device to change the text to make it a little bit different for your eye, and hopefully use the words. He labored over every single word in the text, in every text he ever wrote. So, you know, if you think of how purposefully he put the commas and he put the dashes and he put the capitalization marks, he was definitely using contextual clues in the text to get you to focus on the meaning. So I'm going to read to you, read with me as I read out loud. For the most wild yet homely narrative which I am about to pen, I neither expect nor solicit belief. So he's saying he doesn't really care if you believe him or not. Mad indeed would I be to expect it in a case where my very senses reject their own evidence. He's saying, I'd be crazy if I believed it, but I've seen it with my own eyes, and I still don't believe it. Yet mad I am not, and very surely do I not dream. So he's saying, I'm not crazy, and I'm not dreaming. And notice the commas, notice the dash. But tomorrow I die, and today I would unburthen my soul. So now we know what he's about to tell us is the story of possibly why he's dying tomorrow. My immediate purpose is to place before the world, comma, plainly, comma, succinctly, and without comment, comma, a series of mere household events. So he's giving you four or five direct words to let you know that what he's about to tell you is just regular stuff. Plain, succinct, succinct is very exact, and without comment. Like when he tells you the story, you're not going to even have a comment, you're going to believe him. And it's just mere household events. And if you read the story, you'll know it's not mere normal stuff at all. It's crazy stuff. In their consequences, these events have terrified, dash, have tortured, dash, have destroyed me. No huge words there in vocabulary, but he definitely tries to grab your eye with the dash have, dash have, dash have. Yet I will not attempt to expound them. He's like, but I'm not even going to explain it. To me, they have presented little but horror. To many, they will seem less terrible than baroques. Notice the capital H there. As far as I know, we only capitalize proper names, proper nouns, and holy things like the word God or when you're speaking of God. But he capitalized horror, and he wanted to do that for a reason. He wanted to call your attention about this story is a horrible story, and it's actually happened to me in real life. But don't tell my girls. They don't know we have a cat like that in the backyard. Shh. Okay. Hereafter, comma, perhaps, comma, this telling you a story, some intellect may be found which will reduce my phantasm to the common place. Some intellect more calm, more logical, and far less excitable than my own, which I will perceive in the circumstances I detail with awe, nothing more than an ordinary succession of very natural causes and effects. So his whole first paragraph is, I'm gonna die, you're not gonna believe why, nothing tragic or weird or strange or ghostly happened, even though I'm using the word phantasm. Ah, I hate when I do that. Hold on, I have this clicky problem. I like to click things. Hold on, back up. And here we are. Okay, so he doesn't want you to think the story's a bit crazy. He's not crazy. He's not dreaming. And everything that happens from here on out is just a matter of cause and effect. When you read the story, nothing is normal in that story. Okay, so notice that he uses everything to catch a reader's attention. Not all authors do that, however, and you have to train your eye to look for some of the more common but less frequently used punctuation marks and context clues. So, context clues are words that surround a particular word and help in identifying it. I'm going to go through five different types. Number one, by definition and example. Number two, they're synonyms, or they're comparing or restating. Number three, they're antonyms, or they're contrasting, telling you what's different. Number four, familiar expressions or figures of speech. Number five, mood, tone, and experience. And experience is a huge way of getting the meaning of unknown words. Number one, definitions and examples. So the key words that help define or explain are pretty obvious. They're also called are and were, is and are, means, namely, or, that is, to be, and thus. So if you see here, I've given an example of each of them. A connoisseur is also called a lover, comma, or, expert of fine details, and a person who has a great deal of taste. So a connoisseur is somebody who just looks at like the very minutiae of finer things like art or wine or food or history. You can be a connoisseur of history. You could be a connoisseur of anything, honestly, but the original meaning was that it was of finer things in life. And are and were are just your straight up definitions. Connoisseurs are a rare breed of humans. Is and are, a hybrid is an offspring of genetically differing parents. And then the word means, whatever's on one side is gonna tell you what means on the other. A hybrid also means produced by the interaction or crossbreeding of two unlike cultures, traditions, etc. Namely, hybrids also can have a negative and or a positive connotation, namely a mongrel or a thoroughbred. So the namely names something more particular than a hybrid. So a hybrid could be called a mongrel, and a hybrid could also be called a thoroughbred, and that's actually true. And Freud was a connoisseur or a lover of wine. I don't know if that's true, but it would make sense, wouldn't it? At least on Fridays. That is, Dawn is a connoisseur of chocolate. That is, she is an expert. So when you see that is in the middle of a sentence, it's telling you what the definition of one of the unknown words is. I bet you can pull all the clues and figure it out. To be a hybrid, made secretariat, one of a kind. So to be is not just for Shakespeare. To be is going to tell you what the definition is last on this page. And this is not a comprehensive list. It's a living list, meaning that we could add and add and add to it. I'm only giving the most common ones. Thus, secretariat, the hybrid, was the perfect blend of speed and endurance. That's a great horse, wasn't he? Just great. If you haven't seen that movie or read that, you need to. Okay, so Next, number, we're going to go on with definition and example because there are punctuation clues everywhere. When you see comma separated with the or and then comma, just like I said before, that's always going to be, it's like a scale. Whatever's on one side is going to be the same as the other. So the researcher found an ignite or fossil footprint in the layer of shale. So you see that comma or fossil footprint, comma, fossil footprint means ignite. They are the same. See that? I should use my InnerWrite pad, but you know, let's just get this done. Next, definition sometimes is put in parentheses. Marion set out to establish a greenway, trees running the length of the river on both sides along the Nashua. And next we have definition where we an author puts two hyphens or dashes on the side. So he named the river Nashua dash, river with the pebbled bottom. So the dash tells you this is what that means. And last for punctuation clues is when you see words, terms, or phrases in a series, in those commas, those are your punctuation clues. So pedagogical institutions, including high schools, kindergartens, and colleges, require community support to function efficiently. So I may not know pedagogical, but I know what a high school and a kindergarten and a college looks like. So this must have to do something with process of teaching and learning. I think I pressed something with my toe. We'll just ignore that sound. Okay, next, synonyms, comparisons, or restatement. A word or group that has the same meaning reveals the meaning of an unknown term. So here's some examples. My opponent's argument is fallacious, misleading, plain wrong. So we can look and see that fallacious is being compared to being misleading and plain wrong. And fallacious is wrong, the fallacy and false. All the F-A-L's come from the Latin word, which means to make a mistake or to be at fault. So if you can use your root words that we talked about in words and their meanings, or you can just use your context clues, which are the synonyms that are in the sentence. Next, number two, he was so parsimonious that he refused to give his own sons the few pennies they needed to buy pencils for school. What a meaning. It truly hurt him to part with his money. Don't we all know somebody parsimonious? You don't have to have all of the definition in there to be able to compare it to somebody who wouldn't give their kids money for school, and when they gave you the money, it was like a really big deal. Someone who's stingy, greedy, is parsimonious. So you have to take what you know about the situation and compare it to figure it out. Number three, his pertinacity or stubbornness is the cause of most of his trouble. So I may not know pertinacity, but I know stubbornness. And I see the comma or in the comma, and if he's having troubles, pertinacity is definitely a negative connotation. It's not a good word. And the thing that you're going to look at with words more deeply is, do they have a feeling? Do they feel the same? Do they feel different? Are there words around it that I can get a feeling for what the word means? It's talking about differences, we have antonyms or the contrast. So the key words, and this is not an exhaustive list, but basic, no, stop, hold on, that was on 9, back up, 8, I have to stop touching things. Okay, so here are your key words in the center, although, but, despite, however, in contrast, etc. So examples, Carl was a Manel. Now I can't talk. Carl was a malevolent person, while his brother Jake was considerate and generous. So I have the word while, so what's going to be on one side is going to be opposite the other. So malevolent, considerate, and generous, it's the opposite of considerate and generous. It would be mean and stingy. And mal, the root is, oh, I just clicked on it. Hope it doesn't move. I'm just going to hold my mouse there. Mal is the root word for bad, like in Spanish you say it's malo. Oh, I let go. I have a clicky problem. Sorry. And a cold. Excuse me. Okay, number two. She wore clothing with bright and varied colors that expressed her exuberant personality, whereas he always wore brown, which made him look anything but vivacious. So just looking at the second half. Brown, not colorful, made him look anything but vivacious. So if he wears brown, he's not colorful, okay? And then on the other side of the sentence, I know whereas told me it's the opposite of what's on the other side, and the other side said it was bright and varied. So vivacious must mean bright and varied because he's wearing brown and he isn't either of those. And last but not least, for antonyms and contrasting words, rather than be involved in clandestine meetings, they did everything quite openly. So clandestine means secretly or in hiding. And the rather than tells you that the definition of that word is going to actually be the opposite. And if we see rather than being quite in the open, clandestine meetings must be secret ones, ones that nobody's supposed to know about. And then I'm supposed to click. Number four, familiar expressions or figures of speech. So at times, metaphors and similes may be used to convey meaning. Just like Jay-Z's song, the same thing happens here. The dog perambulated. His movement was as slow as molasses. Well, molasses is like syrup, and that's gooey. I think I like honey and syrup. It's just really thick. And if the dog's walking like that, he's not in a hurry to get anywhere. So perambulate actually does mean to walk slowly. Take your time. And this is just, you know, could be used for dogs, but you can also use it for people. Number two, antiquated buildings were a bridge to the past, singing timeless melodies for all to behold. Fancy, right? Antiquated buildings were a bridge to the past. Well, that's a metaphor. You have a bridge to the past. Can you really build a bridge to the past? No. Can you build one in your mind? Yes. And if it's in the past, it must be what? Old. So antiquated probably means old. And then the sentence goes on, singing timeless melodies for all to behold. Well, timeless melodies is also a metaphor. Maybe a melatonin, I don't know. Anyways, number three, having spent the night palpitating in the cold, Janie's bones felt as old as the earth, or you could say as old as dirt. And so if I've been in the cold before and outside in the cold, and then I felt really old when I got in, that is old as dirt or as old as earth is a simile. And if I'm feeling that old, palpitating was probably shivering. And that's exactly what it is. But you know, you think about what it could it be. Well, if you palpitate something, your heart palpitates, as when your heart beats, when they put those things on, they're trying to get your heart to palpitate in the hospital. And if you're palpitating in the cold, you're literally like doing one of these things. Yes. So moving on, number five, mood, tone, experience. Writers use descriptive words to paint a picture which suggests the meaning of the unknown words. Examples. The lugubrious wails of the gypsies echoed throughout the all but deserted cemetery. Lugubrious, a happy word? Just sounds goobry, right? Lugubrious. It just doesn't even sound like a fun word. It's not. And when you wail, what is a wail? Not the kind in the sea, that's a different spelling. But the wail is a cry, you know, it's the ugly cry. It's that cry where you like don't want anyone to see and you boo-hoo. And if gypsies are wailing, well, gypsies, you know, they travel from place to place, they're kind of nomadic, and they're known to sometimes be thieves. So we've got crying thieves who are in a deserted cemetery. Not any place I want to be, so lugubrious must mean just despairingly sad. The sad cries of the gypsies echoed throughout the all but deserted cemetery. Number two, because the conflagration was aided by the wind, it was so destructive that every building in the area was completely burned to the ground. Well, you don't need to know what a conflagration is to know what happens when wind catches a fire and just sweeps through, because it's the oxygen that keeps the fire going. So a conflagration is actually just a fire. It's a sophisticated way of saying fire. And it's actually in Poe's The Black Cat as well. Number three, the somnolent patient required medication to help her stay awake for more than a short time. So think of that somn root. If you have insomnia, you have the inability to sleep. So someone who's somnolent is somebody who's tired all the time. You know, in that, if you've been with a patient in a hospital or you are a patient in the hospital or you've seen, you know when they have medicine and people look groggy, even if they wanted to, they couldn't stay awake, right? They have that, you know, that kind of pass out nod. That's what that word means. Sleepy, tired. And here, let's take a little quiz and see how you do. Number one, the corpse already greatly decayed and clotted with gore stood erect before the eyes of the spectators. Corpse means dead body, and that would be descriptive, right? All those greatly decayed, clotted with gore stood erect before the eyes of the spectator. Ichthyology. Ich must mean something. And ology is the study of. So ichthyology quickly became my area of study as we examined carp, trout, snook, and sharks. excuse me, words in a series. I may not know what carp or trout is, but I definitely know what a snooky is and sharks. So I'm looking, okay, I know carp and trout and sharks. I never heard of a snook or whatever it is. You look at the series, ichthyologists must mean study of fishes. Number three, and that's words in a series. Number three, the boy who was very vociferous doesn't talk much anymore. So if he was very vociferous and now he doesn't talk much anymore, I'm guessing that vociferous means chatty or very talkative. And let's see. Oh, that's a synonym or a restatement. And let's see, doesn't talk much anymore. Number four, he was magnanimous toward his enemies. People thought he was as sweet as syrup. So we have that figurative language, simile, as sweet as syrup. Who is magnanimous to their enemies? That means he was very agreeable. If you look at magnanimous, you can see magnify in there. Magna is a positive word. And it's big-hearted. It's basically big-hearted. And number five, his pertinacity or stubbornness is the cause of most of her troubles. Her pertinacity or stubbornness is the cause of most of her troubles. You have a comma or comma. So pertinacity means stubbornness. If you're pertinacious, you're stubborn. Number six, the model was so narcissistic that she stared at her reflection in every mirror she passed. So somebody who stares at themselves, you know by experience, I have a little girl who every chance she gets, she's looking at herself in the mirror, and I'm always saying, stop staring at yourself in the mirror. You didn't change from 5 minutes ago. That's a little bit of narcissistic behavior. Narcissism or narcissistic means somebody who is in love with themselves. And the word comes from Narcissus, which is from a myth. Number seven, celestial events such as sunrise, sunsets, and eclipses are governed by calculable laws. So celestial, I don't know. If I don't know, I'm going to look at the words in a series, and I'm going to say sunrise and sunsets and eclipses, and that has to do with things out in space. So celestial must mean having to do with the stars or space, and that's exactly what it means. Number eight, the elated athletes jumped up and down as the winning goal reached the net. So they won, they jumped up and down, it's a happy word, elated. And I'm using the words around by the example that I see. And so I know elated must mean excited and ecstatic. Number nine, fortunately, the nauseating dizzy spell was transient and the player did not succumb to the ghastly smell of the opponent's repugnant body odor. So you've got nauseating dizzy spell. That's never good. I've had that. Not any fun. It was transient. So transient, trans is transportation. I know transport. Trans means to go through something. So is this something that is permanent or is something that went through quickly? Let's keep fortunately nauseating dizzy spell. Don't want that. Did not succumb to it though. And whoever his opponent was had a ghastly smell, and it was a repugnant body odor. You know, like that sub shop smell. So the word fortunately, if you look back here, though, it's saying it fortunately, even though he had the dizzy spell, he didn't succumb to that stink. So the transient word must mean temporary, because if it was intransient, he would have passed out. But it says fortunately, he did not. And you have to look at all the words surrounding the words you don't know. Number 10, the Titanic with its mammoth, massive, leviathan frame was supposed to be unsinkable. So we have words in a series again, and we have by example, it was supposed to be unsinkable, but it wasn't. captain made a very bad error. Okay, and that's it. Those are the answers. If you want to scroll back and forth and test yourself again, thank you for coming, and I'll talk to you later. We'll make more videos soon. Bye.